Thank you for standing by. At this time, all participants will be on a listen-only mode until the question-and-answer session of today's conference. At that time, to ask a question, you may press star followed by the number one and record your name at the prompt. And this call is being recorded. If you have any objections, you may disconnect at this time. And now I'll be turning the call over to Ms. Heather Mayer. Ma'am, you may begin.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Mission Lifeline, Enhancing the System of Care for STEMI Patients in Iowa. The American Heart Association's Mission Lifeline and Acute Care have partnered to provide this continuing education for you today. Acute Care is accredited by the Accreditation Council for Continuing Medical Education to present CME program for physicians. Acute Care designates this continuing education activity for 1 hour of Category 1A credit. Physicians should only claim credit commensurate with the extent of their participation in this activity. All planning committee members and speakers have declared there are no relative financial arrangements or affiliations with the organization that may affect balance, independency, objectivity, or scientific rigor of this CME. Our speakers have no disclosures related to this presentation. Dr. Richard Mulvane does consult and speak for AstraZeneca. However, those topics will not be included in today's presentation. We will start our program with the introductions of our speakers, followed by a discussion of the systems of care with Dr. Alwadani, the Iowa statewide STEMI guideline with Dr. Edward Zajac, and a discussion on the use of lytic therapy in the STEMI patient with Dr. Richard Mulvane. We will have several minutes at the end of this program for questions. All lines will be muted until that time. It is my pleasure to introduce our speakers to you today. Dr. Abdullah Alwadani is an interventional cardiologist and the medical director of the Heart and Vascular Center at Great River Medical Center in West Burlington, Iowa. He is a graduate of the University of Jordan and has completed his advanced cardiology training, including his residency and fellowship at the University of Iowa. He is certified by the Board of Internal Medicine and the Board of Cardiology, as well as the American Board of Interventional Cardiology and the American Board of Vascular Medicine and Endovascular Therapy. He is a Mission Lifeline Chair for Iowa, a member of the statewide STEMI Task Force, and a member of the Interventional Cardiology Steering Committee. Dr. Edward Zajac is a graduate of the University of Illinois Abraham Lincoln School of Medicine in Chicago, where he completed his residency in internal medicine and his cardiology fellowship in 1987. He has served as an associate professor of clinical medicine at the University of Illinois Hospital and was the medical director of the coronary care unit and the cardiac transplantation program. Dr. Zajac has been practicing interventional cardiology in Sioux City since 1998 and is currently the medical director for the cardiac cath lab at Unity Point St. Luke's in Sioux City. He is the current chair for Mission Lifeline Statewide Task Force and a member of the Interventional Cardiology Committee. Dr. Richard Mulvane is a clinical specialist pharmacist at Essentia Health Heart and Vascular Center in Duluth, Minnesota. He is a graduate of the University of Minnesota College of Pharmacy. He completed internships at United and St. Paul's Children's Hospital in St. Paul, Minnesota, as well as the Veterans Affairs Medical Center in Minneapolis. In 2008, he completed his University at Minnesota College of Pharmacy Pharmaceutical Care Certificate Program for Medication Therapy Management. In December of 2008, he passed the Board Pharmaceutical Specialty Certification in Pharmacotherapy. In May of 2009, he was the first pharmacist in the state of Minnesota to be awarded added qualifications in cardiology by the Board of Pharmaceutical Specialties. We welcome our speakers today. We will begin with part one, the STEMI system of care, presented by Dr. Abdullah Alwadani. You are now the presenter, Dr. Alwadani.
Yes, thank you, Heather. Good morning. It's my pleasure to kick in this webinar. I'm not really sure how many of you had enough sleep since last night. I hope that you have enough coffee today, and I hope that we keep this interested to keep it interesting so that everybody's still going to be with us. Mission Lifeline Iowa is funded by a generous grant from the Helmsley Trust. It's $6.1 million. The goal for it is to enhance systems of care, save lives, and improve outcomes of heart attack patients. We are really thankful and grateful. The initiative is directed and designed by the American Heart Association. The goal is to advance the systems of care for ST elevation myocardial infarctions, or what we call STEMIs, and out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. I believe we do, or at least our intention is to do the best job to take care of these patients. When you look at the data, you'll be amazed that we're really not doing that good like we thought. This initiative is one of many nationwide initiatives just to improve the whole process of care, for specifically for those patients. We would like to use all of your support to promote the build and promote the ideal STEMI system of care. We want to bring everybody that is involved to be on the same page. We believe that this initiative is unique is that it really takes care of the patients from the moment that they get contact with any medical services till they're discharged from the patients. We are really interested in supporting the local medical services, whether it's EMS services or local hospitals. We are in full support of rural communities to enable them to do the best they can to take care of those specific patients. We understand the differences between rural and urban hospitals, and we like to explain how we're going to join efforts of both areas to achieve our goal. The grant covers 3 years. We're hoping that after that we will be autopiloting. The task force is literally. We had to have leadership because Heather Meyer asked us to, and we have plenty of advisory committees. The initiative and the task force support every part of the process, from equipment allocations to protocol developments. We are heavy on educating our providers and our communities. One of the major emphases will be data collections to see exactly how the things are working and what's working, what's not working. We would like always to get feedbacks, whether instantly or in conferences. And again, the initiative covers meetings and conferences. I don't know if people are tired of looking at maps and colors. This time it's yellow and white, not blue and red. You can see that all of our counties are eligible for the funding. The participation has increased dramatically in the last year. This is the organizational scheme of the initiative. You see a lot of names. You see a lot of committees. All these people are glued by one goal, which is trying to do the best of taking care of STEMI patients and out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. I don't want you to be confused by how this slide is presented. It shows you four quadrants of areas of care. We don't look at it this way. We see it as one continuum. The system of care for STEMI patients, we think, starts right at home with the patient and their family. We'd like to push for education for signs and symptoms, and we like to emphasize the use of 911. We believe that there is a lot of work that can be done if the patient is dialing 911 and not driving themselves to the hospital. National data shows that, especially in the state of Iowa, most of the patients that are presenting with STEMIs are actually driving their own cars. The local EMA services role is critical. Timely response, assessments, care, 12 EKG performance and interpretation. We believe that this is the key for the whole process. Then we go to the referring hospitals. The referring hospital will take it over from the EMS services. They will activate the treatment plan following statewide approved guidelines. And then finally, the receiving hospital, which we believe that they will deliver the end therapy. We want the relationship between both the referring and the receiving hospitals to be as strong as possible, and we'll do this through continuous feedback. This is why this whole initiative really is heavy on data collection. We believe that it needs to be a simple one process. So an EMS agent recognizes the process, activates the plan, the referring hospital following receiving the activation, starting the protocol even before the patient gets there, and the receiving center is just waiting to deliver the end goal. We believe that all this will result in improving outcomes. Heart attacks, especially the STEMIs, is dependent heavily on time, muscle damage is literally dependent on a minute of reperfusion. We believe that the patient outcome will depend on a very smooth transition between these three modalities. You're all familiar with the times. I'm not going to go through details. The guidelines, I'm pretty sure that are in front of you. We want to achieve this not 90% of the time. We want to achieve this 100% of the time. Nobody deserves anything less than this. I'm going to jump on this right into the data collection. You'll see how we are really heavy on data collection. Without the data collection, we are blind to the outcomes of our efforts. We will be basically dependent on personal perspectives and personal opinions. This is not the right thing to do. We are heavily engaged in the action registry. It's a very busy registry with a lot of questions. It will require dedication. It will require time and effort. But we think it's very important and critical to our success. The reports that are generated will be sent to both receiving and referring hospitals. Communication to us is the key. Trying to jump to the main point. The last thing that I'll talk about is our recognitions. You can see that hospitals and centers, EMS services, will be rewarded based on their outcomes. the reward is not just a recognition. We believe that at some point, state agencies will be reporting services that we provide based on our performances. These will be probably required for monetary and regulatory accreditation. We would like all our services to be golden because we believe they are. I'm going to stop here. I tried to just highlight the main points of the initiatives. I really think that this is good work. A lot of good people are involved. I think we will achieve what we all look forward to, which is just do the best that we can to improve the care of heart attacks in the state of Iowa. I'm going to take this to back to Heather.
Great. Thank you.
And please feel
Thank
free.
You so much, Dr. Al-Badani. So this recognition, these opportunities, well, you know, recognition is great. We all like to have plaques and banners. This has been something very inspiring in Iowa. You know, when we collect all of these data, and as Dr. Al-Badani and I were talking earlier, every one of these patients that we're inputting into this tool is a little over 300 data points per patient that we're looking at on all of these folks. And so when we use it to help drive the quality, then it results in these awards. And in Iowa, we've had several EMS Mission Lifeline Awards as well as hospital, and those go to Mercy in Sioux City, St. Luke's Hospital in Sioux City, Trinity Regional in Fort Dodge, Mercy Medical Center in Des Moines, Mercy Hospital in Iowa City, Live Fire Department, Council Bluffs Fire Department, Dubuque Fire, and Medic EMS in the Quad Cities have all been recipients of Mission Lifeline, and those were all the results of their applications from their data collection in using this process. So thank you again, Dr. Al-Badani, for that presentation. So at this time, we will turn it over to Dr. Zajac to talk about the Iowa statewide STEMI guidelines.
Well, thank you very much. Good afternoon to all the participants, and we're going to talk a little bit about the guidelines and how they came about. The guidelines, and after we talk about that, we'll talk about some specific STEMI criteria, then go into the guidelines in a little bit more in depth. And I do want to save a bit of time at the end to discuss some of the questions that have come up with a lot of our partners from the standpoint of emergency room care and the EMTALA rulings. So first of all, some basic facts here. Most cardiologists are still going to be in business. There's a large number of patients who present to the emergency room with chest discomfort. And the ER physicians are in a difficult situation. They have patients coming in. They may not always have 100% of the objective data in front of them, and they need to be able to sort out, is this a serious issue? Is this related to an acute coronary syndrome, or is it non-cardiac chest pain? And that's not always an easy task, and we certainly appreciate that on the receiving end of patients. But roughly a quarter of those patients who come into emergency rooms with chest discomfort end up with acute coronary syndromes, and cardiology generally is involved with their care shortly afterwards. Of those patients, about 400,000 are in the category of STEMI, and that's really where the focus of this initiative is, and we're going to spend our time describing that in a little bit more detail. I'm sure all of you are familiar with this format, and we now have some guidelines, and we have good medical data and recommendations that all communities, they need to create, maintain a regional system of STEMI care. And, you know, that is given a high priority. CMS funding agencies are all going to follow along with this. And it's important because we've already seen, at least in our community, advancements. And with the data collection that we've already spoke about here earlier in the talks, really will help to solidify that. So this is our steering committee. We had, and it was somewhat of a daunting task, to be very, very honest with you. We started out with every STEMI program in the entire state of Iowa. We had representatives from all of those programs, all those people. Everyone has an opinion. Everyone likely trained at different institutions. Many of them had personal practice patterns that may be a little bit different. Most of them were all correct, but there may be some mild changes that were identified. And what we were able to do, which is crucial for this project, is to take every single program in the state of Iowa that has a PCI program, and we were able to, over time, develop a consensus of care. And we spent a lot of time and effort, and I think ultimately it provides a very succinct guidelines that everyone agrees upon. And I think it makes those individuals who are caring for the patients at the front end a much easier task, because they know that if their patient goes to STEMI Center A or STEMI Center B, that everyone agrees on the basic overall management. And we modeled many of our consensus statements over some of the other states who were able to provide us with some help and assistance, and be able to identify things that were successful for them. Ultimately, we arrived at a consensus statement, and I think it's gone quite well up to this point. So let's focus a little bit just on the STEMI criteria. Again, this was what was agreed upon, and most of it follows Heart Association guidelines on a national basis. We really wanted to make certain that everything fell into place appropriately. There are some differences between men and women that are subtle. Those with ST segment elevation, there was a measurement at the J point, and we'd like to see two contiguous leads of greater than 2 millimeters of ST segment elevation in the anterior leads and or a millimeter in other contiguous chest leads or in the limb leads. Women are just slightly different with that. It is a little bit less voltage required, so it's 1.5 millimeters in the anterior precordial leads, and the remainder is the same. Obviously, we're practicing clinical medicine, and so we want to be able to capture those patients who are most suspicious for an acute event. So the signs and symptoms do become important. We want to be able to capture patients who are in a time frame that they will receive the most benefit. So up to 12 hours, they're considered for this STEMI guideline for an interventional pathway. We had a lot of discussion about left bundle branch blocks. There's a small subset, everyone is aware of it, but there are those patients who don't present with classic EKG ST changes, but have a left bundle branch block. There are always discussions, is this truly acute or not? But we felt that it was important. We don't want to miss that patient because typically those are fairly large and extensive infarcts. Fortunately, I think with many healthcare systems, electrocardiograms from the past are more widely available, and that can help out to determine if this is a new left bundle or one that was pre-existing. And then the last point is that, you know, again, at the front end for infarcts, at the EMS level or in the emergency room, this is a very fluid and dynamic system. You may have someone with risk factors who has a great story for an infarct, and the EKG doesn't show anything dramatic. And we always have examples where 5 minutes later, they're not doing well, the repeat EKG becomes diagnostic. And so we don't want people to become complacent at that front end and be able to be diligent, and it may require some repeat electrocardiograms. So we need to know what normal is, and this is a beautiful electrocardiogram, sinus rhythm, no ST changes, and we're happy if someone comes in with this type of electrocardiogram and may have a reasonable symptomatology concerning for an acute coronary syndrome, one would need to repeat it. And in fact, this is a common scenario that we see, that a follow-up electrocardiogram may not be so normal. And in this case here, we've got a fairly classic pattern for an anterior infarct. We've got ST segment elevation in the anterior precordial leads, as we see here, V2, V3, and V4. But more importantly, and as we teach, and a major part of this initiative is to teach EKG readings to many people at EMS levels that may not have done it in the past. And the things we really focus on will be not only the identification of ST segment elevation, but the reciprocal changes as that current of injury and that vector is directed anteriorly. You're going to see reciprocal changes, and in this case, in the inferior leads. And that can be very helpful in improving the diagnostic sensitivity and specificity that this truly is a STEMI. Our hopes and goals, and part of this initiative, is that these electrocardiograms are going to be obtained in the field, in the patient's living room, and so that the ball changes. This is very different as far as our practice in the past, where patients got to a hospital, got to a rural hospital. We want the clock to start at the event, and the electrocardiogram can be transmitted to other personnel who can assist in the process of managing the patient. Again, the infarct care for patients coming up in the future is in their living room. It's not at a PCI center. We are there at the final end to do the touch-up, and that should be all. So, again, this covers most of what we've discussed. Our hopes and goals are that the electrocardiogram is obtained at the site, and those EKGs can then be transmitted, hopefully, to the local programs, but also to the STEMI receiving hospital. If there are personnel that are not available in-house, we can have those people get there and accelerate the time that we're able to receive care for the patient. And lots of tricks have been learned already. And I think the second point here is very crucial and important. There's a real paradigm shift for the individuals who are seeing patients up front. We still ask them to worry about all the medical things, but we now ask them to think, how are we going to transport this patient? Are weather conditions such that air transport may not be possible? And these are things that we're going to ask providers up front to make early decisions on. If they're able to fly, that helicopter needs to be notified very early on. They may be able to meet the patients en route. They may be able to assist with the transport at one of the rural hospitals. And our goals over time will be that more and more air transport is going to take place en route to a PCI center. It may be at some designated landing zones. Again, this is a change in how we manage these patients. We can go through some of the primary PCI pathways. And again, the goals are fairly robust in most rural areas. At my program, we have patients who are traveling from even 100 miles away. And so many things have to happen quickly and appropriately. If you look here, we want that first medical contact, which is going to be by paramedics, to PCI, less than 120 minutes. That's 2 hours. That's not a lot of time. So many people need to coordinate their care appropriately. We want some of the care to be initiated immediately, and that's the goal. So paramedics up front may be managing oxygen therapy in people who are hypoxic. We don't want to use oxygen carte blanche only for those people who truly need it. Aspirin up front, we want to be able to have defibrillator pads available. We want to assess their pain. We want to relieve some of that pain, hopefully with analgesia, nitrates perhaps, and then have some IV established. Our hopes and goals that much of this is going to be taken care of en route or perhaps at the rural-based hospital. Some form of heparin should be given, and we, again, have a lot of loose guidelines. It can be what is preferred at a local level, whether it's unfractionated heparin or enoxaparin. They're both acceptable. Patients who clearly are having a STEMI, there's data to support some early loading with additional antiplatelet agents. Brilinta has an indication for this, but there are alternatives that are acceptable. What we don't want to have happen is, and I know Heather always will tell us this, the nurses have a checklist. Everything needs to be checked. And again, this is a bit of a paradigm shift. We're going to ask a lot of our providers, our early providers, to prioritize. We would love to have other data available, but not at the expense of transport time. Transport time for a rural-based patient is paramount to getting a good outcome. So again, if there is time and we are in the process, you know, we'd love to have a nice IV. There's data to support high-dose statin therapy, potent high-dose statin therapy. We would love to get some early laboratory data on a patient, but the caveat is they do not wait for those results. They can draw the lab test. The patient can be sent off. We can always catch up with lab data. We live in a world of electronics today, and it's very easy to, or easier to move around information than it was in the past. We would also try to minimize and not necessarily just treat patients by rote. I mean, beta blockers are wonderful if the patient is hypertensive, but they don't need to be treated for every patient acutely. We want to save time, we want to get them moving, and we want to be able to expedite their care. So the referral hospital priorities is that they need to make certain that there was an electrocardiogram, whether it was obtained in the field, or to be able to get it in their rural hospital ER, and we've set some goals. I think we've already seen a lot of improvement in these areas at our rural-based hospitals. We want to get that first EKG within 10 minutes. I think that's a very reasonable early goal. We may even tighten that goal up over time. The important thing, again, is everyone needs to be notified. So we want to empower. We want to empower many people at different levels to recognize a STEMI and call a STEMI alert, whether that is the EMS in the field that has an electrocardiogram, the triage nurse who's first evaluating that patient, even in the rural hospital settings. We need to know ahead of time so we can get people here. We've already talked about arranging transport. That needs to be very upfront. And if there is a trigger pulled, or a helicopter team. There are no problems if 5 minutes later we say, no, it's not truly a STEMI, or perhaps the weather does not allow us, but we do need to activate those systems very early on. I think another system is that we're going to have more tiered transport than we've had in the past. We may start out with an EMS service at the bedside in someone's home, taking them partway along the interstate, and then hooking up with the paramedics who are there in air transport. They have even more sophisticated techniques that they can help to expedite patient care in flight. One of our goals we've established, and I think it's a very reasonable goal, is the door in or door out. And that should be less than 30 minutes. There are lots of tricks that we are learning along the way to achieve that. You know, one of them is, well, why do we take a patient who's in a paramedic transport system and then take them off the cot and put them in a bed, only to know that we're going to turn around and likely transport the patient out of that rural care system? Why not just leave them on that cot gurney system, and that can save time? So at the end, let's talk a little bit about EMTALA. My ER colleagues just shiver when you talk about this because it's real. And EMTALA violations are serious infractions, and we are all aware of them. I think, again, there's a shift in how we manage patients. And if you look carefully at Medicare and EMTALA guidelines, it states very clearly that you should go to the nearest appropriate facility. And so if there is a patient in rural America who's having a STEMI, the most appropriate nearest facility is a PCI-capable facility. So there should be no concerns about any EMTALA violations in which a EMS crew will go around a rural hospital and go directly to a PCI-based hospital. We often will use some of the rural-based hospitals because they all have very nice heliports. But one warning here is that if the patient goes to one of these rural-based hospitals and the clear plan is to go to the appropriate facility, which is a PCI facility, the staff at that rural hospital cannot be involved in the management. And so we can't have staff or physicians or nurses run out from the rural-based hospital. They may be well-intentioned, but they cannot be managing the patient on the helipad at the rural-based hospital. That is a concern and a violation, and that's been dealt with on some specific instances. So again, to kind of highlight this, there should be no concerns about EMTALA violations because the patient with a STEMI is going to the appropriate facility. And in this case, it's a PCI-based facility. And then lastly, if the utilization of the heliport at a local hospital is used, the staff need to take a step back. And I believe that I'm going to turn this back over to Heather, and I'm going to let her continue with some introductions. Hopefully, we will have some time at the end for questions.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Dr. Zajac. With that, we will jump right in with Dr. Richard Mulvane and finish up our conversation on with fibrinolytic therapy, and then we will open it up for questions.
Thank you, Heather. Richard Mulvane, I am the co-chair of the Minnesota Mission Lifeline Project. I'm actually at St. Mary's Hospital here in Duluth, I'm going to talk about fibrinolytics for STEMI and some kind of tips and tricks here from the pharmacist perspective. The star here shows our facility here in Duluth, Minnesota, right at the tip of Lake Superior. We have a large rural system. I know Iowa has a lot of large rural areas as well. And then you're to be congratulated for coming together and getting a nice state protocol very quickly and much faster than we were able to do in Minnesota. We're talking about acute coronary syndromes, the big one. This is it. And when you have a clog in your artery, it's kind of interesting. You know, we have interventional techniques and we have chemical techniques to open up that that blockage. And Mission Lifeline has been teaching us for years that Plan A robustly is primary PCI. The data still is very strong. But we still need lytics as our Plan B. And there's some cases where lytics are very appropriate. So we're going to kind of talk about that. Just a quick story here. Way up on the Canadian border, we had a guy chopping woods up by his cabin there. He's probably almost 4 hours from Duluth because the roads are so slow. Called 911. Here's his EKG. I think everybody can see this is a big, huge anterior STEMI. And the volunteer fire department had just obtained their new EKG machine through the Mission Lifeline grant. So this was their first EKG, and it happened to be a STEMI. And they were an hour away from the regional hospital on the North Shore. And so they were able to make that trip down the bumpy road. And because they knew that he was coming, they were able to give the clot-busting drug TNK or Tenecteplase literally within 15 minutes. The chopper wasn't available, so they trucked him down to Duluth to the cath lab. And sure enough, en route, this happens almost half the time with lytics, the chest pain returns. And so we activate our cath lab. Go in and do what's known as rescue PCI, and his LAD is blocked halfway down, and we were able to fix that. But the story here is the lytic actually bought him some time here, so that was actually very good news. He had a really good outcome. I won't comment on it, but we even though it's a STEMI, we want people to be safe and not drive too fast. We have to be realistic with what our ETAs are. And then this gentleman, he didn't like the bumpy road up in, by the Canadian border, and he actually wrote a check for, I think, almost $20,000, and he said, get a new truck with better shocks, so it was kind of cool. So he was a recipient of Tenecteplase TNK, or a lytic, which is what we're talking about today, and when we have a blockage, it's kind of like a pipe when you give a lytic. You may open the pipe, but there's still junk that remains behind, and we've known this for years. And a fibrinolytic it stands for lysing or cutting of the fibrin strands that kind of mesh up the platelets and the red blood cells eventually. So it actually lyses fibrin, not thrombin, so it's not really a thrombolytic. Lytics can cause serious bleeding. There's a lot of nervousness about using fibrinolytics, especially our biggest fear, which is intracranial hemorrhage. The lytics work great if the chest pain onset is within the last hour or two and that clot hasn't really had a chance to set up. Those fibrin strands haven't really, you know, woven a bigger mesh, if you will. And as we know, if the symptom onset is greater than, say, 4 or 6 hours, the lytics just don't work as well. However, according to guidelines, we'll still have to consider them in some cases. TNK is... Tenecteplase is an improvement on the previous lytics. You know, streptokinase was very antigenic and a lot of reactions to that. TPA was our next one, but that one took about 90 minutes to give. There's a retoplase out there, RPA, which can be infused over 2 minutes, and then 30 minutes later you have to do it again. But tenecteplase is a five-second bolus, and it has a much longer half-life than the previous lytics. So that's why you can get away with kind of a one-shot deal. When you give a lytic, it's not just about the half-life, though. The hemodynamic system is kind of in a roller coaster of bleeding and clotting and lots of instability. Then this can persist for, you know, 2 to 3 hours or more. And so that's why we don't like to rush these people straight to the cath lab if we've just given them lytics, because there's a lot of bleeding risk associated with that, as well as some adverse outcomes in some trials. Lytics are actually cleared by your liver, so you don't have to adjust the dose based on kidney function. And again, the TNK half-life is about 22 minutes. So it is going to hang around for at least five half-lives doing its thing, and the rebound effect can last a little bit longer. So that's why we like to wait about 2 or 3 hours, in fact, 3 hours per guidelines before you would want to take these people to the cath lab, unless the lytic doesn't work as well and they don't have ST resolution of 50% or more within that period of time. Lytics, the older ones were worse for side effects. The new ones don't have this as much, but be aware that there are certainly a list of side effects that could happen with giving the Lytic. The other thing that comes up, and I know in Minnesota as well as Iowa, you know, when you choose to give a Lytic, there isn't data on the new P2I12 inhibitors. So clopidogrel or Plavix is the one that we do have the data. So if you are going to give a Lytic, we generally would give clopidogrel. 300 milligrams up front. A lot of times when they get to the hospital or cath lab, we might even bolus them again. Or if they're over 75 years old, then consider reducing that dose to 75 milligrams of clopidogrel. And in this case, don't forget the heparin IV bolus and drip. If you're giving a Lytic, you know, again, you're making those platelets really angry in the anticoagulation system. So you can't get away with just a heparin bolus. These people need a drip. And because they got a Lytic, hopefully you have a little bit more time to do that. So from our last guidelines, which who knows, maybe we'll have some new guidelines soon, but just to focus on the one specific recommendation, patients should be getting reperfusion if that STEMI is less than 12 hours old, or in some cases up to 24 hours if there's, you know, ongoing ischemia. But most people don't generally give Lytics if that symptom onset is certainly, you know, 12 hours or more. And a lot of times, even if it's 4 or 6 hours or more, they're going to try for primary PCI if possible. And the other thing is you have to think about is contraindications. And so we'll talk about that. But if there are no contraindications and you can't get primary PCI in 120 minutes, then fibrinolytic therapy should be strongly considered. And for those who have a non-STEMI or ST depression or potentially, this could be a left main situation, but we do not give Lytics for non-STEMI in summary there. If you are going to give a Lytic at a regional hospital, I hope everybody knows this, but the door-to-needle goal should be 30 minutes or less. And if the Lytic is successful, again, between 3 hours to 24 hours later is really the optimal time to bring them back to the cath lab. And this is actually from Mission Lifeline, or adopted from the guidelines, just kind of this flow of how things should go, choosing this mixed strategy of going to hopefully primary PCI if it can be done in a timely fashion, and then if not, give them a Lytic, and if that, and then you still transfer them to the STEMI receiving center. And so this brings up the lessons we've learned in the Mission Lifeline projects, is that it's easy to say, well, you're a STEMI hospital and you're not, but really every hospital is a STEMI hospital because it could be snowing, the choppers aren't flying, and in a lot of cases, you know, the regional hospitals are the STEMI hospital because they can give that Lytic and they can give the other STEMI meds and then eventually, you know, transfer by ground sometimes instead of air if they're not flying. But that's what's the beauty of what you've done in Iowa is you have a great protocol that works whether or not the patient shows up at the regional hospital or the STEMI hospital. I was given this data from you guys very recently that 14% compliance was in your action data showing the administration of Lytics in Iowa. And what does this really mean? Well, I think it suggests that there probably are more opportunities to consider giving Lytics, especially if you're not making it to PCI in 120 minutes. But I don't actually feel this is an alarming number because you're probably not that far off. In Minnesota, you know, I think we're thinking in large rural systems, the sweet spot is probably still under 20% Lytic use. So that's actually not too bad, but there is data to suggest that perhaps a little more Lytics could be considered based on data. And so here's your guideline, which was already shown previously. As you notice, there's a large laundry list of contraindications for Lytics. Some of these contraindications are quite old, in fact, over 20 or 30 years old, based on information from streptokinase, which is technically no longer even available in this country anymore. In Minnesota, we actually made some slight modifications. I'm not saying you have to do this in Iowa, but we got together with some thought leaders from Mayo Clinic and others and said, well, we don't need to talk about streptokinase because it's not available. We do need to update these new direct oral anticoagulants, novel anticoagulants, and as well as pregnancy. We really felt that should be an absolute contraindication. We asked for a survey. Is there any cardiologist in the room who would advise giving lytics to a pregnant female? And not a single one jumped on that. So the other issue now with these new blood thinners, like, you know, Pradaxa, Xarelto, Eliquis, are they an absolute contraindication? Well, yes and no. It depends on how long ago they took their medication. We have a lot of people comfortable giving lytics if the INR is low. We're not comfortable, but they would consider it. But in general, if they are on anticoagulants, for the most part, we do try to avoid giving lytics. Let's see. Okay. And so here is the dosing chart for giving the lytics. Hopefully you have access to this guideline. And I created this chart, and I guess you could call it going viral because they stole it and put it on yours, which is great. And there are options, or there are circumstances where a half-dose lytic could be considered, and I'll talk about that in a second. Well, I already talked about this. TNK is very convenient, 5-second bolus, and that's why it has been chosen. It comes in a box. It's a kit. It has to be mixed. It actually has to be diluted. Here's a quick picture of that and the nurses who administer this. It isn't just snapping your fingers. You got to put a little thought into this. And as a pharmacist, I know you don't want to shake it too much because it foams up pretty bad, so swirl it gently. Okay, back to the half-dose information. For those over 75 years old, in Minnesota we adopted this based on the STREAM trial. It was a trial that was looking at people who couldn't get primary PCI within 60 minutes. So then they compared that with lytics, and the outcomes were very comparable. However, as the trial was rolling along, those over 75%, the intracranial hemorrhage rate was 8%, which is incredibly bad. So they modified the trial midstream, and they went to half-dose lytics for those over 75. And for the duration of the trial in that cohort, they had zero strokes after that. And then they were still included in the final analysis to have similar outcomes with those who couldn't get PCI within an hour. So we did adopt that in Minnesota as an option for those over 75. And here was the reference on that. And I mentioned that as well. There's also some thought, and I don't know if this happens in Iowa, there is an institution in Minnesota that does give half-dose lytics followed by, you know, immediate PCI. And this was actually just recently downgraded in last year's CPR ECC guidelines as to a class 3 level of harm. It's still controversial, but I'm sharing with you what the guidelines say. However, there is actually some institutions that are still out there doing that. This is just a wrap-up of how we adopted our protocol, again, this mixed strategy. And it's all deciding on the ETA. For the most part, you know, can you get the PCI within 120 minutes? And if not, then consider lytics if they're eligible. And so we have a PCI arm on the left, but then we have the lytic arm on the right. And there's the little caveats of the drug dosings that I've already talked about. So I'm looking at the clock, and that's about all I have to say about that. So I'm going to turn this back over to Heather, and I will be available for questions.
Great. Okay. I think at this time we're ready to open it up to any questions. Dr. Mulvane, thank you so very much.
Thank you. We will now begin the question and answer session. To ask a question, please press star followed by the number one. Unmute your phone and record your name clearly when prompted. Your name is required to introduce your question. And to cancel your question, you may press star followed by the number two. One moment, please, while we wait for questions. We
just a note, while we are waiting for any questions, this is recorded, obviously, and it will be offered as an enduring CME over the course of the year. We did have a lot of requests for that.
We show no questions in queue. Again, as a reminder, to ask a question, you may press star followed by the number one. To cancel your question, you may press star followed by the number two. One moment, please, while we wait for questions. We show no questions in queue at this time, speakers.
Very good. Thank you so much. Again, I would like to thank Dr. Abdullah Wadani, Dr. Edward Zajac, and Dr. Richard Mulvane for your time today and for being great champions of Mission Lifeline and providing this education for us. Thank you all.